Mm-hmm.
Two.
Mm-hmm.
Three.
Mm-hmm.
Tonight on Real Life, the emotional story of two-year-old Fleur Tobert and the family who must learn to live with Fleur's extremely rare and disfiguring illness.
Yeah.
It's an illness that can transform an ordinary little girl into a fragile old woman in only 10 years.
You know, people are like, oh, you're so brave. What's there to be brave about? She's my daughter. You know, I love her, whether she's well or unwell. Whatever she looks like or whatever, you know, we'll always be very proud of her and, you know, won't hide her away or anything. We'll do all the, as much as possible and live life to the full for her.
It's Fleur's birthday. But although she may only be 2 years old, deep inside her body is aging fast. She has an incredibly rare illness called progeria. It affects only 30 children in the whole world. And it means that in less than 10 years' time, she will look and feel like an old person. And she will probably die long before she ever becomes an adult. So for Mark and Becky, their youngest daughter's birthday is a bittersweet celebration.
It's another year gone. And you think, how many more birthdays is she going to have?
Oh, posh!
Everybody's happy and it's nice to see Fleur happy. But then it does hit home, is she going to be here for her third birthday?
Fleur was Mark and Becky's second daughter. She was born 2 months prematurely after a relatively normal pregnancy. But almost immediately she began to suffer from a variety of mysterious symptoms. Excessive vomiting, bow legs, and her skin appeared dry and papery. The family spent many days and nights at Bedford Hospital, but the doctors were baffled.
Deep down, I always knew that there was something wrong with her. And then they managed to get an appointment at Great Ormond Street. And they said, right, your appointment will be within the next 5-10 days. Mark's like, oh, that's good, you know. I was like, yeah, that's good, but you don't get an appointment at the top hospital in the country that quick for no reason.
Beck seemed to be thinking the worst, and I was trying to think the best. In looking back, Beck was right.
Do you count in then? One, two, three.
The day before we went, we had a function next door, didn't we, in the garden barbecue.
I didn't really want to go round there. And it was the first time I'd ever said it. I sat round here, my mum came round and said, you know, come on, Lucy's having fun, etc. And I just blurted it out. I said, Fleur's going to die. It was the first time I'd ever said it, but I knew there was something seriously, seriously wrong with her.
We arrived on Monday, didn't we?
Yeah.
Our heads were spinning. They couldn't have done more. The amount of professors from each area of expertise was phenomenal, wasn't there? Rheumatologist, neurologist, geneticist, I mean, just everything. I mean, our heads were just spinning. On the Tuesday, they just come up to us and say, do you mind having Fleur's photographs taken for hospital records? I said, no problem at all. So we go down to the basement, where the sort of studio is, and they give you a slip of paper, just saying, can you sign an authority? And it reads something along the lines of, I consent to my child's photos for the reasons that's given and stated over leaf. Now, we hadn't been given any particular reasons, had we? So I turned it over to see what it said. And all it said was this word, progeria, which, while they're from the photo taken, I got a pen out and wrote it on my hand. It was August, it was nice and warm. We'd put in a buggy and walked around London. And you saw a bookshop and said, well, let's go and look that word up. And I found it eventually in this large English dictionary. I wouldn't let you see it. And
I said, what does it say? And he goes, it doesn't matter, let's go. And I said, no, tell me what it says. I need to know what it says. I can't remember your exact words. And you said, oh, it's that aging thing, I think. Obviously, I got upset. I was crying. I can remember the woman in the shop saying, do you need to sit down? Obviously, look that. And then I can just remember you pushing the buggy, me grabbing hold of the back of your shirt, and you dragging me out the shop.
Within 24 hours at Great Ormond Street, Fleur's consultant, Professor Peter Clayton, confirmed the diagnosis. She did have progeria.
Progeria is a genetically determined disorder. The consequence is that children develop features which would normally only develop in an elderly person during the childhood years. Babies with progeria look essentially normal, but during the childhood years, the loss of fat from below the skin, the loss of hair, the change in the shape of the face makes them look unusual, and there's often a false assumption that they are mentally impaired, which they are not.
So, mentally normal, children with progeria have to watch themselves as they acquire the strange physical appearance that they all eventually share. And they must come to terms with the fact that they will usually die in their teenage years from coronary heart disease or a stroke, the illnesses of old age.
Progeria is triply cruel because not only have you got the prospect of dying young, you look strange, and because you look strange, everyone looks at you. And in our society, in all societies, the images that societies make, that human beings make to frighten themselves, are of strange human beings. And so it's not surprising that people with progeria are thought to be the origin of the idea of goblins.
The only reference you could find to Fleur's condition was in horrible terms. Probably books 100 years ago, and it was saying, it talked to these kids being what we refer to as goblins in them days. So that was all we knew up there. So we had a few days, didn't we, of it just going through our minds of how, in my mind, thinking, God, you know, what's she going to end up looking like?
The first 2 days, once she'd got diagnosed, we did nothing with her. We'd kiss her good morning and good night. I just couldn't look after her. It was like when we found out we sat in the park, I couldn't bring myself to look at her.
But when Becky did look at her child, the first question she wanted the professors at Great Ormond Street to answer was, how long will Fleur live?
I can remember on the last day there, I did force Prof Clayton into a corner, and like I said, give us a wild guess. Which is probably out of order, but I had to do. So he said he obviously didn't want to say, because he can't say, but I said a wild guess. And he said maximum 10 years.
There is no easy or comfortable way to give news about a disorder that has very serious implications. What I try and do is to make sure that I'm certain, as I can be, that that is the correct diagnosis and the outlook is as I think it is. I hope I was able to comfort them a little, but it's very frustrating, it's very upsetting to see a child having very serious medical problems.
Who are you talking to me?
I was petrified about bringing her home. I was scared, so I was at home on my own, and something happened to her. What am I going to do? Run up and down the street screaming, you know, I'm on my own at home.
We used to say, your words were, I'm being left with a time bomb.
She is still now a ticking time bomb. One day it's going to go off.
Happy birthday!
Lucy, help. Yeah?
Fleur Tobert was the youngest child ever to be diagnosed as suffering from progeria. She's aging 10 times faster than a normal child.
Okay. Can you give her one to Shapley, please?
The doctors do not expect her to live more than 10 years.
20.
1, 2, 3.
Fleur's sister, Lucy, was only 4 years old when the original diagnosis was made.
19, 20. I'll lay down.
I feel really sorry for Lucy.
Yeah, I do.
All right.
I mean, we'd love to protect her from it, wouldn't we? But we can't. So that very first weekend, we told her what's wrong with Fleur. We just said, you know, Fleur has an illness where she's going to age.
She kept saying, didn't she? She said, well, when's she going to get better? And what's going to happen? Yeah. What's going to happen?
Mm.
And then, like, you said, didn't you, about getting to the end, and she like said, didn't she? Did she sell you? So she's going to go live on a star. What's going to happen to Fleur?
She's going to
when she gets older. She's going to what, darling?
Die.
Is she? And where's she going to go live when she dies?
Heaven. In the sky.
It is, isn't it? Hey.
Is it in really in the sky?
It is. She'll go live up near the stars, won't she?
Can I go up there with her?
Can you all? You'll go up there one day, but not for an awful long time,
you'll
will you?
You'll go before me.
Oh, but I'll be an old lady then, won't I?
I'm giving
you. Fleur was originally diagnosed in August 2000, but after that, there was nothing much the doctors or the family could do. Progeria is an illness so rare that it seems no one really knows anything about it.
We just felt so isolated, didn't we? When you told your child's got a condition that affects 30 people in the world, you think of my class at school was 30 kids. Do you think of dispersing them through every country in the world? It just makes you so, you know, isolated.
Alone.
And that hits you, doesn't it?
Mm.
So, of course, the first thing you do is look at the internet.
The web gave Mark and Becky their first images of other families with children, alive today, suffering from the illness their daughter had just been diagnosed with. Families like Heath and Kathy Parr from Dallas, Texas, and their 11-year-old son, Chris.
I was watching a television show, and they had a little boy on there with progeria, and just really interesting watching him. And then Chris and I went out to play ball, and I put a baseball cap on him, and he kind of resembled this little boy. And right around 6 years old, he had a stroke out of the blue. And at 8 years old, we finally got the diagnosis of progeria.
There's only 5 kids in the United States that have it. And it's difficult. An expert on progeria could have seen 2 kids in his lifetime of practicing medicine over 50 years. Back in Dallas, the hospital that we go to, they have only seen 1 other child, and that was 40 years ago.
In fact, Mark and Becky were reassured to hear of some experiences that mirrored their own, like the story of Heather Barnett from Michigan and her 6-year-old son, Ori.
Don't stop!
Stop! See you later.
He was throwing up his food, so we had to take him to the hospital.
I got mommy.
And one of the doctors noticed he had bumps on his legs, so we went back to his pediatrician. And the doctor looked at him for about 20 minutes and said he had progeria and sent us home. We were very frightened. I was surprised that we made it home because the doctor, he explained a little bit, but not a lot. We found out most of our information from the internet.
The internet also revealed that there were only a handful of doctors in the world who were trying to understand this condition.
It's easy enough to say that it's early aging. I mean, if most of us look at these children, you take one look at them and everyone agree they look like little old people. The truth of it is that that's partly right and partly wrong. Parts of the bodies of these children age fast. For example, their blood vessels. That's why they get strokes and heart attacks. Parts don't. For example, their brains and their immune systems. They don't get any more cancers or Alzheimer's disease than any other 5-year-old does.
But despite the international spread of the illness, Doctors don't seem to be able to offer much hope to parents in Mark and Becky's situation.
We cannot reverse the basic process because we don't understand the basic process. We have some rare disorders where you can do something very simple and completely correct a genetic defect, and that's wonderful. But yes, there are disorders like this that are at the moment frustrating.
We clearly don't know what causes it. There's some of us who think we do, but it's not proven. And what we think is going on is that the clock in the cells for these children has run down early. If you look at the cellular clock, the genetic clock within their cells, at birth, that clock reads 80 or 90 years old.
No. 2 years after Fleur's initial diagnosis, it's hard to know the exact state of her condition, but ordinary life for the Tobert family is growing into a complex and exhausting routine centered around the care of their youngest child. Fleur's physical movements are already showing signs of deterioration because of the worsening condition of her bowed legs. She eats very little and seldom keeps down what little she eats. Her breathing is often labored, and she seems to spend most of every night awake. As often as not, Fleur herself seems happy, but Mark and Becky are increasingly exhausted.
What are you going for the 8 p.m. ones?
Mark has a full-time job as a detective constable with Bedford CID. Becky would like to return to work, but Fleur's condition makes it difficult for them to think of anything apart from the competing needs of their two daughters.
We expect an enormous amount of parents. Mark and Becky have coped remarkably well. They're having to attend the local hospital, a specialist hospital. We expect them to religiously give the medications we prescribe, and it's often worthwhile just considering whether one actually would cope with those things oneself, and what effect it has on other members of the family, a brother or sister, who's to a degree being neglected because everything centers around this child's illness.
Daddy!
No, come on, what? You've been a monkey.
Indeed, despite being the elder sister, Lucy goes to bed first. It can take up to 3 hours to get Fleur into her cot.
Say sweet dreams.
Coming on my knee, it's only in your chair.
Look, Mummy.
Pardon?
Look.
Rock. Now I'll rock you once you've had your monk.
Looking after Fleur during the day may be difficult, but more often than not, night after night, it's even worse.
You like to think you don't need help. Most people don't like to ask for help. And you like to imagine that you've got this child with this condition, but her needs are the same as another child. But we soon, after a few months, realised it wasn't like that. You do have extra stresses. Every week almost there's an issue. The lack of sleep, because Fleur has strange sleep patterns, which are unexplained. She's had sleep studies done on her. And I should imagine for the last 2 years, we've not had more than 5 hours sleep a night. And you end up with your whole life almost becomes a blur. Day after day, week after week, month after month, it was really getting us down, wasn't it? So we needed help and we had to ask for help. Which, as I say, isn't an easy thing to do. Everything seems to become a battle. And when you're in that position, every battle probably seems 100 times worse than it should be or needs to be. So it took us quite a long time, didn't it, to get things in place. But we do get a few hours a week from various places, don't we, in the daytime, which gives you a little respite.
Nah. What are we going to do with your mum?
I get 16 hours a week help at home. I have one carer, 2 5-hour sessions, and then social services provide 6 hours a week, with a carer coming in twice a week for 3 hours. That's it, which probably sounds an awful lot, but it's not. You know, when they come around, I'll try and go to Sainsbury's. You know, it's a treat going to Sainsbury's on my own, which sounds really sad, but it's a break, it's getting away. You know, Mark always says use it, sleep, but of course there's always things to do that I can't do when I've got Fleur.
Fleur?
Huh?
You got to beat up your nose. Yeah, not there. You quite often.
But the most significant help the family have comes from the local children's hospice. When the time finally comes and Fleur dies, Mark and Becky are planning that it should be here. So Fleur has been coming to stay at the hospice regularly for the last 2 years. Whenever Fleur is here, the whole family, including Becky's parents, are welcome. But sometimes Fleur stays here on her own, to give Mark and Becky some respite. It's the only place they feel comfortable leaving their youngest daughter to stay overnight.
Maybe we can get the motor. Shall we get the scooter out?
But since this is the place where Fleur may die, any visit here can prompt difficult reflections.
When we first find out, the amount of people that come up and say, it's both of us, you know, or you're so brave. Bravery is not part of it. You've got no choice, you've got to do it. You know, you've got no option. The option isn't, we say this to each other, you know, you either carry on, you go mad. There's no middle ground. People don't like to talk about it, particularly blokes. I think more people probably speak to Becky, because women are more into speaking about emotions and stuff. And I'd say that 90% of the people that come up and say, "How's Fleur?" don't particularly want to know. I don't mean, I say, I feel sadness and you know. But I just try and, you know, you just got to try and soldier on. But I've always said from day one, obviously the inevitable's going to happen for her. I'd rather it happen before she has to know what's wrong with her, or she lasts as long as she possibly can.
This is a room which is called the special bedroom. This is a room where a child comes once the child has died. The child can stay here until the funeral, because the bed is like a refrigerated bed. It's like cold. don't really go here in my head. Not to this room. I know one day she is going to be in this room. It sounds awful talking about Fleur dying. Like I say, I hope it's, you know, many years away. But I know it's going to happen. it's reality. I will cope. Somehow. Don't ask me how I will, but I will. Like I say, I can't run away from it.
How often do you think about it?
About Fleur dying?
Yeah.
Truthfully?
Yeah.
Probably every day.
Really?
Yeah.
I mean, is that that it comes up and just hits you like a truck, or...?
It's the first thought probably on my mind as soon as I wake up, and the last thought on my mind when I go to sleep. How can it not be?
Two years ago, when Mark and Becky first discovered that their daughter was terminally ill with progeria, they sent a cry for help in an email to the Progeria Research Foundation in the United States.
You just put help, didn't you? Our daughter.
It's a very short email.
Help, our daughter, our four-month-old daughter, Fleur, has been diagnosed with progeria.
And so there was a response, wasn't there? A reply half hour later. The only way I can put it is like something out of the Close Encounters film. It's like someone from outer space making contact. And it was quite emotional receiving that email back, wasn't it?
Through this, the family discovered the Sunshine Foundation, who host annual reunions to which all the known progeria children are invited. Determined to make their daughter's short life as full as possible, the Tobert family went to their first reunion last year, and they plan to continue as long as Fleur lives. But a week before setting off to this year's reunion in the Sunshine Foundation's Dream Village in Florida, Fleur is suddenly taken ill and rushed into Bedford Hospital. In February, Fleur had suffered a mini stroke, and she's now showing disturbing symptoms of fluid retention.
So this came up, when did you notice it first?
Yesterday.
And
it's a possible sign of heart failure, and children with progeria are known to have very fragile hearts.
That's not normally there.
So it's harder and firmer?
Yeah, it's not normally that big at all. And then, like, she's put on a couple of pounds in a couple of days.
She had a mini stroke, TIA, in February. That was a big shock. Youngest child that I've ever known to have a TIA with her condition is 5. Fleur wasn't even 2. So, you know, that was obviously scary. Now, you know, when words like heart failure come out, it's like, Christ, this is really happening.
In an attempt to understand what is happening to her body, Fleur will now be subjected to a barrage of tests and procedures, from high-tech ultrasounds and ECGs to low-tech blood pressure tests.
Lots of people said, don't know how you cope. I couldn't do it. If somebody beforehand had, like, said, I was going to have a terminally ill child and be in this situation, I'd say I wouldn't be able to cope. But when it's here, you've just got to get on with it. I've got no choice other than to deal with it. The best I can. I can't run away from it. It's not going to go away.
Tomorrow, isn't it?
The family still hope that they may be able to travel to America, but the first battery of tests have revealed something new and disturbing. Fleur's blood pressure is fluctuating wildly from too high to too low.
It's not normal. So why isn't it normal?
It's never been normal
since
she was born.
No, but it's never been that. It's normally high. Why all of a sudden is it going so low?
Physical symptoms, don't they? Not just what that shows.
Yeah, but like it's saying she doesn't feel pain and stuff. They can't.
Well, I don't know what you're supposed to feel. You probably don't feel anything if your blood pressure goes low. You probably feel weak.
No, but you know
that's
what
you probably feel weak, isn't it? If your blood pressure's low, you probably
there's
go
no
flu,
telling me Fleur, is there? No, I'm telling you now, if she's still got the swelling and they don't know about blood pressure and stuff, and if they're not 101% sure it's not a heart, she's not going.
It's times like this that put the family under extreme pressure. Mark is having to work late nights this week, so while Becky and Fleur are in hospital, Lucy is staying with grandparents. These are long days and lonely nights for all the family. On the third day of her stay at the hospital, Fleur is taken for an electrocardiogram. This is the first test that may reveal something about the state of her heart.
Right, nearly done. She said the ECG was all right, so I said, right, okay, so you've ruled out the heart then.
But does, I'm going to say, does that rule it out?
Well,
or just
can't be 100% positive, no. Because she said the symptoms are swelling in the legs, abdomen, liver, and stuff
so
like that.
So what would show up if you've had a heart failure?
I don't know.
So what they're saying about it, there's no way to find out if she'd had a heart failure then.
Oh, well, I don't know. Will you ask her?
Finally, the hospital schedule an ultrasound scan of Fleur's heart.
No, 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 it's not going to hurt. No. No.
Good girl. Here we go. Very brave, aren't you?
You nearly done. We're going to see pictures.
Watch the pictures on the telly.
She's brave, you.
Is that your tummy?
Oh, come down.
Pretty, look, pretty.
I think the physician would be very happy with the results of this.
The tests have not revealed any obvious signs of heart failure.
Come on, we're going now.
Hey, you're in your chair now.
Good girl.
Good girl.
But it's still not clear what was behind the specific symptoms that brought Fleur into the hospital in the first place. And since progeria is already an incurable and fatal illness, the family really cannot tell how serious the situation may now be.
It's just frustrating, sitting around, and it's the not knowing that's the hardest thing to cope with. You know, you just want to be told, what's the matter with you today? Okay, we'll move on, get sorted out and move on, and you know, get home. Don't like being here at all. Just want to get home and get back to as normal a life as possible. Every day here is a day out of Fleur's life. It's scary, very scary. I know I'll never be ready for the day when she's gonna die. But all my head's saying, we're not ready, I'm not ready. It's too soon, but any day is gonna be too soon.
After 3 days of inconclusive tests at Bedford Hospital, Mark and Becky are taking Fleur to Great Ormond Street Hospital in London to see Professor Clayton.
Who's that?
Oh, there's Dr.
Who's that?
Professor Clayton was the doctor who first diagnosed Fleur as suffering from progeria 2 years ago. As far as Becky is concerned, it will be up to the professor to decide whether it's safe for Fleur to go to Florida.
Can we sit you up for a minute?
All right.
And do you think that she'll be all right to fly? I know you can't say 100%. I know that, but you know me, I have to ask. But if you say you don't know, then I'll accept you don't know. But, like, at the local hospital, they're like... Sorry.
Well, I just think my view is if she isn't going to get any better, so if you said no this year, it'd be no forever to go on a plane, really.
There's no strong evidence for a major heart problem, liver problem, kidney problem at the moment. And by and large, we wouldn't expect one this early in any case. I'd say 98% sure you'll be okay.
She won't blame you if anything happens,
don't worry. No, you know what I'm like.
She's the only person she was happy to listen to be fair. And I know you don't know the answers, but...
You're spoiled, aren't you?
Full massage,
isn't
it?
Daddy's turned like that, Fleur, in his dreams.
Is it nice? Yeah. Is it nice having the cream on? Yeah, I see it is.
Two days later, the family set off for Florida. This year, the foundation has only been able to invite one parent per child to the reunion. But Mark and Becky have been offered, by Mark's father, the use of a holiday villa in Florida. So they've decided that Mark will attend the reunion with Fleur, while Becky will use this rare opportunity to spend some time alone with Lucy. For Becky, it will be the first time she has ever spent 4 days away from Fleur. And for Mark, it will be the first time he has ever spent 4 days looking after his youngest daughter entirely on his own.
Did you lose your doll?
The Sunshine State greets the Sunshine Foundation in a less than traditional style. But rain will not deter 30 different children from 15 different countries who are taking advantage of this unique opportunity to spend time with other children exactly like themselves. Six-year-old Ori Barnett and his mother Heather have flown down from Michigan, but like Fleur, it was touch and go whether or not he would be able to come.
Ori loves to come to the reunions. He had a stroke in June, and he was so looking forward to coming to the reunion that I couldn't tell him, well, honey, you can't go. I had to bring him.
Oh, pretty close.
It's really important to come to the reunion because he can see that he's not alone. He's not the only child that looks like he does. He can play with these kids and just have fun. He doesn't have to worry about the stairs and people asking questions, you know, because the little kids, they stare.
Ori doesn't yet know exactly what Progeria is, but for some, like 11-year-old Chris Parr, coming to the reunion has meant coming to terms with the reality of his illness.
Just before we came here, we sat down with him, told him, you know, there'd be children there, all different ages. Some would look like him, some might be a little bit different, but that y'all basically have the same symptoms going on, and then in the long run, what would happen? That, you know, most children don't make it past their teenage years. And that was hard for him, you know, we had to tell him. He got upset, of course, which upset us, but it was something we needed to do.
Fleur was the youngest person ever to be diagnosed with progeria, and the oldest little girl at the reunion is only 14. So for Mark, it's a chance to get a glimpse into Fleur's future.
You can't help but look at the kids and say, that's what my daughter's going to look like then. It's just a natural thing to do. Every year passes, another year gone. So you are going to look and see how, you know, try not to sound cruel, but
we've met all these kids last year, so you are going to look at them this year and see, you know, have they progressed, do they have they changed. They all, or those at the age, all know what's wrong with them. But they don't get remorse for bad anything. You will not see any bickering, any bad words said amongst these kids. Now, I defy you almost anywhere in the world to find kids that get together and there's not some bickering over a toy. And there's not a thing, they're just total joy, total enjoyment.
But along with all the joy, there is inevitable sadness and even anger.
I get angry because it's unfair for anyone to have to go through this. And he's my son. If I could take this disease, I would. But there's nothing that I can do. I get angry. And I get angry at God for giving Ori this.
The few days of the reunion are an opportunity for all these children to spend some time together. With day trips to theme parks and restaurants, gathering all the world's progeria children together at one place at one time is not seen as an opportunity for medical research.
So a couple of the nurses said she had the features of a steroid sort of baby, you know.
Well, they're talking about the steroids that she makes, for example, corticosteroids, you know, you don't know.
Yeah.
However, Dr. Mike Fossil, who's been studying this illness for years, is always invited to attend for one day, in case any of the parents want to chat about their child's condition.
In the past, there'd been a lot of medical involvement, but the families rightly felt that that medical involvement consisted of poking, prodding, measuring, and doing nothing. Now, it's largely a place where the children can go and have fun, and families can go and meet other families who have the same problems that they have.
Say Mike.
But for a doctor who believes he may be on the verge of discovering something, the lack of medical research can be frustrating.
It's poignantly painful. And the reason is, I have a feeling that we know enough to know how to intervene and that we'll be able to get there, but not soon enough. It would be easier in some ways to think we had no idea what to do and never would. Because you know that no matter what time you get this figured out and can intervene and cure some child, it's still been too late for many of them.
Mark has spent the last 3 days looking after his daughter Fleur on his own at the Sunshine Foundation's annual reunion for children with progeria.
There's a feeling of emptiness in me, knowing that Becky and Lucy aren't here, experiencing what I'm experiencing. The kids have a short enough life as it is, and Becky is missing out on these joyous moments, you know. I've really enjoyed having Fleur to myself. As a father, although you spend time with your children, you know, whenever I'm at home with Fleur, yeah, I'm alone with Fleur, but there's always something else on my mind. So it's very rare that you get a chance to spend pure time just to enjoy. And out here, I've really, really enjoyed having that time with Fleur.
Shut the door. You're changing out now. Might as well get you undressed as well. Nappy. There, you get me a nappy and a bag. Bag.
Yeah.
I only want one.
Yeah.
I only want one. Put them ones back. Put back.
It's the last day of the reunion. And Becky and Lucy have been invited to join Mark and Fleur for the farewell party.
When we first discovered what Fleur had got, and then we started looking on the internet, it's horrific. Now, only I could say that, or Mark could say it. But it is horrific. And to know that's what she's going to turn into and be like. That's why this week's like so important, to see once you've got over the initial oh god, and people are going to stare, then you realise inside they are normal children.
Mummy.
Yes, honey. It's John.
John is family. I mean, we learnt so much last year, didn't we? We came with this child, we're told that this condition, No one in England, the top professors, can tell us a thing about. And yet we come out here and we can see what the future holds for our daughter. And the future holds some fun times, isn't it? Yeah, they're totally different and I wouldn't wish it upon a child. But they are cute and lovely and stuff. And they're so pure.
The last night party is always the children's favourite evening.
So much fun, and that's what you see tonight. Obviously, I don't know how every single child lives their life, but I can imagine that they're very easy to become very introverted. But you'll see some extrovert behaviour tonight, and I'd very much doubt they're normally like that. This is one week where they can come out themselves, be like everyone else who's amongst them to an extent. Every other week of the year, they are on their own. There is no one else in their locality in the main that looks anything like them. So they can come here and they can just relax, and they're out and they're just running around, causing havoc, really. But just having a way of the time as any other child would. I just find it amazing. There's never any side to them.
Ah, little Shakira.
But this year's last night party is not just a joyous occasion. During the week, one of the group, Greg, died. To mark his passing, all the remaining children come together. And not sharing a language, they sign a song in his memory.
To be told that a child's died is obviously the biggest reality check to hit you, really. It was probably just as well I was on my own. You know, I've got the huge lump in my throat. No matter what they say, you'll be here in my
heart. Always.
The first thing is you do think of your own child, and one day that is, you know, you are going to be in that situation where your child's going to die. Always,
always, I'll be with you. I'll be there for you always, always and always.
Smash it.